My dear learners, for this course on finite element analysis. In this module 2, we are discussing on analysis of bars and trusses. So far, we have completed our discussion on analysis of 1D bar elements. In our previous lecture, I have derived expression for stiffness matrix, stress, and also elemental forces which are required for analysis of trusses. So recalling the expressions which we have derived in our previous lecture, let us solve numerical problems on analysis of trusses from today's lecture. Before heading to start solving the problems, the very important note is that coming for the forces what are applied on the trusses are analyzed based on the coordinate system sign convention. That is, if the force is acting in the x direction like this, sign convention if I want to address. So if I consider the coordinate system with four quadrants, force acting in the positive x direction is considered to be positive, force acting in the negative x direction is considered to be negative, that is force acting from right to left is considered to be negative, whereas force acting from left to right direction is considered as positive, whereas force acting upwards in the y direction is considered to be positive. If force acting downwards in the y direction, it is considered as negative. So therefore, here the 12 kN what is acting should be taken as negative. This is the one very important note. Coming for the second very important note is that we should fix the origin for this truss for analysis. I can fix origin at node 1, I can fix origin here, and also I can fix origin here. Always remember, try to fix the origin such a way that the entire truss will lie in the first quadrant. This is because of the reason, if I place the entire truss in the first quadrant, all the nodal coordinate values will be positive, because in the first quadrant we have plus and plus. The x direction will also have positive answers, the y direction will also have. So always try to place the entire truss in the first quadrant in order to avoid confusion and also to solve the problem easily. So therefore, if I place the origin at node number 1, the entire truss will lie in the second quadrant. If I place the origin at this point, then element 1 will lie in first quadrant, whereas element 3 will lie in second quadrant. If I place origin here, then the entire truss will lie in first quadrant. So therefore, I will place the origin here. Thereby, the analysis will become simpler. You can also place the origin here and solve. You can also place the origin here and solve. You will get the same answer. But there might be confusions because of minus and plus signs which are coming in between. So therefore, in order to avoid confusion, always place the origin such a way that the entire truss lies in the first quadrant. I can place the origin such that the entire truss will lie in the first quadrant if I place the origin here. So therefore, for this problem, I will place the origin here. For analysis of this problem, I place the origin at this point. If I place the origin at this point, the entire truss will lie in the first quadrant itself. So this is the second very important note. Place the origin such that entire truss lies in first quadrant. So with these two very important notes, let us solve the problem number 1. The problem number 1 of our discussion on analysis of truss states that for the two bar truss shown in the figure, determine the nodal displacement, stress in each element, and reaction at the support. Take Young's modulus E as 200 GPa and area as 200 mm². So since he has not specified area separately, which means that the area of element 1 as well as element 2 are 200 mm² respectively. So now, if I go for solution, the first step is to find the nodal coordinate data. So therefore, so before moving to nodal coordinate data, let us draw the finite element model first. So if I go for finite element model in step number 1, pick up the element of truss separately and indicate the displacements what we have to compute for each element If I take element number 1, so we have element 2 like this and element 1 like this. So for element 2, the node numbers are 2 and 3. So this is element 2 and we have load acting on element 2. So for the moment it does not consider the load. I want to determine the displacement U2 and V2 for node number 3. I want to calculate U3 and V3. If I take element 1 at node number 2, I want to calculate U2 and V2, whereas at node number 1 the displacement U1 and V1 at node number 1. So this is about the finite element model. So for element 1 the nodes are 1 and 2, for element 2 the nodes are 2 and 3. Always remember, the element node number are analyzed in the local coordinates as 1 and 2 only, because each element of the truss is a bar in its local coordinate system and each element have only 2 nodes. Whereas the initial node for any element is the least global node number. So if I consider element 1, the global node numbers are 1 and 2. The least among these two is 1, so therefore 1 is initial node, 2 is final node. Similarly, if I consider element 2, the global node numbers are 2 and 3. The least global node number is 2, higher is 3. So therefore, 2 is the least global node number for this element. Hence, 2 is the initial node and 3 is the final node. Hope you understood. For that element, the globally least node number is the initial node and remaining is the final node. So for element 2, 2 is the least global node number and 3 is the remaining node. So therefore, 2 is initial node, 3 is final node. What I mean to say is that between 2 and 3, 2 is minimum and 3 is maximum. So therefore, 2 is initial, 3 is final. That's all. So now, moving for step 2. That is nodal coordinate data. We have the node number and the value of x at that node and the value of y at that node. So totally we have 3 nodes. So node number 1, node number 2 and node number 3. So this is the origin we have fixed, because the entire truss will lies in first quadrant. So the value of x1 is 500 plus 400 is 900, whereas the value of y1 is 0. Similarly, the value of x2 is 500, y2 is 300. x2 is 500, y2 is 300. For node number 3, since it is coming on y-axis, so therefore the value of x is 0, the value of y is 300. Hope you understood, all the dimensions are in millimeters. So this is about nodal coordinate data. Next, moving for step 3. Direction cosine table. So if I write the direction cosine table, we have element number. For that element, we have initial node and we have final node. So therefore, I want the value of x initial, x final, y initial, y final, and length of the element. Length of the element is given by root of x final minus x initial whole square plus y final minus y initial whole square. Similarly, finally we have the direction cosine L is equal to cos theta, which is given by x final minus x initial by length of the element, and L is equal to sin theta, which is given by y final minus y initial by length of the element. So if I formulate the direction cosine table, so we have element 1 and element 2. We have only two elements. Now for element 1, the initial node is 1, the final node is 2. For element 2, the initial node is 2, final node is 3. So now for element 1, the nodes are 1 and 2. So therefore I should write x1, x2, y1, y2. So the value of x1 is 900, the value of x2 is 500, similarly the value of y1 is 0, the value of y2 is 300. So for element 2, the nodes are 2 and 3, so therefore I should write x2, x3, y2, y3. The value of x2 is 500, the value of x3 is 0. Coming for y2, we have the value as 300 and y3 is also 300. Now coming for the length of the element, using the formula we will get the length of the element 1 as 500 minus 900 whole square plus y final minus y initial is 300 minus 0 whole square under the root. So the answer is 500. Next, coming for element 2, it is 500 square under the root square root will get cancelled, it is 500. Through the visual inspection itself also we can state the length is 500 only. So therefore the lengths of both the elements are same. Now coming for the direction cosines L and M, for element 1 it is 500 minus 900 divided by length of the element is 500, which is minus 0.8. coming for M, it is 300 minus 0 divided by 500, which is 0.6. coming for element 2, the value of L cos theta is 0 minus 500 by 500, which is minus 1. And for element 2, we have 500, sorry, it is 300 minus 300 is 0, 0 by anything is 0. Now I can verify whether the values of L and M are correct or wrong by inspecting element 2. For element 2, the initial node is 2. So at the initial node, we should measure the angle from the positive x direction in counterclockwise direction. So therefore, from the positive x, if I measure the angle in counterclockwise direction, what is the value of theta? The value of theta is 180 degrees. What is cos 180? Cos 180 is minus 1, sin 180 is 0. So cos pi is minus 1, sin pi is 0. So the answer what we got is also correct, hence the tabulation is also correct. This is how we can verify. Because here I don't know the angle, so therefore I cannot find the values. If I want to find the values here, so this angle will be 180 minus this angle. So this angle is known to us. So this angle is turning out to be tan inverse of opposite by adjacent, that is 3 by 4. Tan inverse of 300 by 400 is 36.869. So therefore 180 minus answer is 143.13 degrees. So this angle is 143.13 degrees. So from that also we can calculate. So cos of 143.13 is minus 0.8, correct? Similarly, sine of 143.13 will be plus 0.6. This is also correct. So you can also calculate by calculating the angles. Directly you can compute the values of L and M. So from angle method also I verified I am getting the same answer. Next, moving for step number 4. Step number 4. From step 4 onwards, the analysis remains same as what we did for analysis of bars. Step number 4 is element stiffness matrix. The element stiffness matrix K of an element is given by AE by length of the element, L square, LM, LM, M square. Now, diagonally you write the same thing, I will get L square, LM, LM, M square. Now, you multiply the negative sign for these four terms and write it to the right side of these four elements. I will get minus L square, minus LM, minus LM, minus M square. Now, diagonally you copy the same. I will get minus L square, minus LM, minus LM, minus M square. So this is the value of element stiffness matrix which we have derived in our previous lecture. So now substituting the values for element 1, I will get for element 1, K of element 1 will be, so the area is 200 into Young's modulus is 200 GPa, so therefore it is 200 into 10 to the power of 3 megapascals MPa. Now angle is divided, length is known to us, length of element 1 is 500, so therefore I will get the value as 8 into 10 to the power of 4, so 8 into 10 to the power of 4 and the values of L and M are known to us. For element 1, the value of L is minus 0.8, so it will become minus 0.8 whole square, which is nothing but 0.64. Coming for L into M, it is minus 0.8 into 0.6, which is minus 0.48, so minus 0.48. M square is 0.6 square, which is 0.36. So once I calculate the four values, that is enough. Now diagonally copy the same, the 0.64 minus 0.48 minus 0.48 0.36. So multiply negative sign and write it to right side, minus 0.64 plus 0.48 plus 0.48 minus 0.36. So if I write diagonally, I will get minus 0.64 plus 0.48 plus 0.48 minus 0.36. So now the further simplification will yield us the value as K of element 1 will become, so multiply 8 inside, if I multiply 8 inside I will get 0.64 into 8, which is 5.12. so therefore I will take 10 to the power of 4 outside and I will write it as 5.12 minus 0.48 into 8 will be minus 3.84, so minus 3.84
and 0.36 into 8 will be 2.88. Now we copy the same. We have 5.12 minus 3.84 minus 3.84 2.88. So multiply negative sign and write. 5.12 will become plus 3.84 plus 3.84 and 2.88. So here I will get, so multiply negative sign, so should get negative here. Then we have minus 5.12 plus 3.84 plus 3.84 and minus 2.88. So this is the element stiffness matrix for element 1. And once you are done with the element stiffness matrix of element 1, write the respective displacements what need to be computed for element 1 above and sideways of this element stiffness matrix. This is very, very important to construct the global stiffness matrix. For element 1, the displacements to be computed are u1 v1, u2 v2. So therefore, I will write it as u1 v1 u2 v2. Here also write u1 v1 u2 v2. Next, since the value of area and Young's modulus and length, all the three remain same for element 2 also. So therefore, I will get the 800 to the power of 4 as common factor, but whereas the direction cosine are different for this. So coming for direction cosine, we have L square is minus 1, whole square is plus 1. So therefore I will get H. L into M is 0 into anything is 0. L into M is 0. Then M square is 0. So therefore, I can complete the matrix as minus 8, 0, 0, minus 8, 0, 0, 0, plus 8, 0, 0, 0. So that's all for element 2. Now for element 2, the displacements to be calculated are u2, v2 and u3, v3. So therefore, write u2, v2, u3, v3. U2, V2, U3, V3. So once you are done with element stiffness matrix, next is to find the global stiffness matrix. Next step is step 4. Step 5 to find global stiffness matrix. Global stiffness matrix, you have to compute the global stiffness matrix for stresses. The order of the global stiffness matrix is 2n cross 2n. This is because of the reason at each node we should calculate two unknowns, that is u1 v1, u2 v2. Hence the order of the global stiffness matrix is 2n cross 2n, where n is number of nodes. So this problem has 3 nodes, so therefore the order of the global stiffness matrix is 6 cross 6. So these 6 are nothing but the displacements to be calculated. The displacements are u1 v1, u2 v2 and u3 v3. So therefore, write down the 6 displacements. So if I write down the 6 displacements, I will get u1 v1 u2 v2 u3 v3. So similarly, vertically also you write down u1, v1, u2, v2, u3, v3. Now, so once you wrote like this 6 cross 6 matrix, now I should pick and place the elements. Now, always you choose 4 elements at a time like this. So if I choose these 4, the order is u1, v1, u1, v1. So the order of these 4 is u1 v1 u1 v1. So pick this. So here u1 v1 u1 v1, you place here. So it will be 5.12 minus 3.84 minus 3.84 and 2.88. Next, if I take this 4, the order will be u1 v1 u2 v2. So take this u1 v1 u2 v2, will come here, place here. So it will be minus 5.12 plus 3.84 plus 3.84 minus 2.88. Next, you pick this 4. The order of this 4 is u2 v2 u1 v1. So u2 v2 u1 v1 will come here. So place it here. It will be minus 5.12 3.84. We have 3.84 minus 2.88. Next, if I go for this 4, the order is u2 v2 u2 v2. So u2 v2 and u2 v2 come here. You place it here. You get 5.12 minus 3.84 minus 3.84 and 2.88. So this completes the placement of element 1 in global stiffness matrix. Come for element 2. If I take this 4, it is u2 v2 u2 v2. So it will come here. U2 v2 and u2 v2 come here. So therefore, add to the previous elements, that is plus 8 plus 0 plus 0 plus 0. Now this 4 will come as u3 v3 u2 v2. So u3 v3 u2 v2 will come here. So if I enter, I'll get minus 8 0 0 and 0. Next, pick this 4. The order is u2 v2 u3 v3. So u2 v2 u3 v3 will come here. So therefore, if I place, I'll get minus 8, 0, 0 and 0. The last 4, if I take, the order is u3 v3 u3 v3. So place it here. So you'll get 8, 0, 0 and 0. Fill the unfilled position with zeros. So 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0 and 0, 0. So fill the unfilled position with zeros. So this is how you should formulate the global stiffness matrix. Once you find the element stiffness matrix, write the displacements corresponding to that node, corresponding to that element. So for element 1, the displacements are u1 v1 u2 v2. So write it horizontally and vertically, above and right side of the stiffness matrix. So similarly, you write for element 2 also. Now the order of the global stiffness matrix is 2n × 2n, where n is number of nodes. So here we have 3 nodes, hence it is 6 × 6. These 6 are nothing but the total displacements to be calculated. So write all the displacement to be calculated above and sideways of the global stiffness matrix. Take 4 at a time, read its order, place it. So throughout we have 10 to the power of 4 common. Throughout we have 10 to the power of 4 common. So don't miss this one. Now if I solve and write on the global stiffness matrix, I will get the global stiffness matrix K as 10 to the power of 4, 5.12 minus 3.84 minus 3.84, then we have 2.88 minus 5.12, 3.84, 0 and 0, then we have 3.84, minus 2.88, 0 and 0, next we have minus 5.12, plus 3.84, plus 3.84, minus 2.88. So 5.12 plus 8 will be 13.12 minus 3.84
minus 3.84 2.88 minus 8 0 0 0, then we have 0 0 0 0 minus 8 0 0 0 plus 8 0 0 0. So this is about the global stiffness matrix. So this is our global stiffness matrix. Step 5, where in which we have calculated the global stiffness matrix. Now coming for step 6, that is the load vector. So no need to worry for trusses. In trusses we analyze only for point loads. So for step 6, if I see, we will get the step 6 as the load vector, because in trusses we analyze only point loads. So therefore step 6, if I write, step 6 is load vector. So F is equal to, we have 6 loads possible, Fx1, Fy1, Fx2, Fy2, Fx3, Fy3. That is, at node 1, along x direction, along y direction. At node 1, along x direction also we don't have load, along y direction also we don't have load. So therefore, Fx1 is 0, Fy1 is also 0. At node 2, along x direction we don't have any load, along y direction we have 12 kN, but this is acting in negative y direction, so therefore I should take it as minus 12 kN. So Fx2 is 0, Fy2 is minus 1.2 into 10 to the power of 4 I will take. This is because of the reason, in the stiffness matrix also I have taken 10 to the power of 4 common. Next, coming for node number 3, along x direction, along y direction we don't have any loads, so therefore it is 0 and 0. So this is the load vector for this problem, which is step 6. So now moving ahead for step 7, that is equilibrium equation and application of boundary condition. Next, moving ahead for step number 7. Step number 7 is equilibrium equation and application of boundary condition. Always in analysis of trusses, we always use elimination method of handling the boundary condition. This is because of the reason, the order of the global stiffness matrix is always greater than 4 plus 4. Hence, we always use elimination method of handling the boundary condition for analysis of trusses. So now you know that the equilibrium equation is given by K matrix into Q matrix is equal to F matrix. So the global stiffness matrix is already calculated, which is 10 to the power of 4. 10 to the power of 4 times 5.12 minus 3.84 minus 5.12 3.8400 minus 3.84 2.88 3.84 minus 2.8800 minus 5.12 3.84 13.12 minus 3.84 minus 80. Next, 3.84 minus 2.88 88 minus 3.84, 2.88, 0 and 0. We have 0, 0, minus 8, 0, plus 8, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, and 0. So this is about the K matrix. Into Q matrix is the 6 displacements that are U1, B1, U2, B2, U3, and B3. This is equal to global load vector. The global load vector is fx1 is 0, fi1 is 0, fx2 is 0, fy2 is minus 1.2 into 10 to the power of 4, fx3 is 0, fy3 is also 0. So this is what we have. So now the boundary condition is that if you clearly observe the given problem, node number 1 is completely fixed, so therefore the displacement u1 and v1 are 0. Node number 2 is free, so I should compute u1 and v1. Node number 3 is also completely fixed, so therefore u3 and v3 are 0. So this is also equal to u3 and v3 are all equal to 0. This is because of the reason node 1 and node 3 are completely fixed. Now as per elimination method of handling the boundary condition, I should eliminate the row and column corresponding to the known displacement. So therefore, since u1 is 0, I should eliminate first row and first column. Since v1 is also 0, I should eliminate second row and second column. Since u3 is 0, I should eliminate fifth row and fifth column. Since V3 is also 0, I should eliminate sixth row and sixth column. Now I can eliminate 10 power 4 and 10 power 4. Now if you carefully observe, all the displacements are equal to 0. As per elimination method, in the active rows, the term which is eliminated in its column should be multiplied with its respective displacement and taken to RHS. This you have clearly understood in analysis of bars. But here, this will multiply with u1, u1 is 0, so this will be 0 is 0. If you take to RHS, it does not make any difference. So this will multiply with v1, v1 is 0, so if you multiply 3.84 into 0 and take it to RHS, it does not make any difference. Similarly, for minus 8 and for these two terms also, they are getting multiplied with zeros. If you take it to RHS, it doesn't make any difference. Hence, since the displacements are equal to 0, I will solve for the terms which are remaining, which will give us the correct answer. So therefore, I am not multiplying and taking to right hand side. This is because of the reason all the displacements are equal to 0. Since all the displacements are equal to 0, retain what is remaining in the equilibrium equation and solve, we will get the answer. So therefore, if I retain what I have and solve, I get the answer. The answer will be, we have 13.12 minus 3.84 minus 3.84 and 2.88. We have U2 and B2. This is equal to 0 and minus 1. So if I solve this by using two equations with two unknowns, we have 13.12 minus 3.84, 0 minus 3.84, 2.88 minus 1.2. So the displacements are U2 is equal to minus 0.2 millimeters
and V2 is equal to -0.683 mm. Therefore, we have determined the displacements. The displacements for this problem are the nodal displacements. The nodal displacements are Q matrix is equal to U1, V1, U2, V2, U3, V3. So if I write, we have the answer as U1 is 0, V1 is 0, U2 is -0.2, V2 is -0.683, U3 is 0 and V3 is 0. All are in millimeters. Now, moving for calculating the element stress, we will get element stress as element stresses. Coming for element stresses, in our previous lecture itself, we have derived the equation element stress sigma is equal to E by length of the element minus L minus M plus L plus M into Q matrix. That is U1, V1, U2, V3. So, if we solve for element 1 and element 2, we will have sigma 1 is equal to X modulus is 200 into 10 to the power of 3 divided by length of element 1 is 500. For element 1, the value of L is -0.8. Minus of minus is plus. It is +0.8. The value of M is 0.6. So it is -0.6. -0.8 into +0.6 multiplied by Q matrix of element 1. The Q matrix of element 1 is U1 V1, U2 V2. U1 is 0. V1 is 0, we have U2, V2, so therefore U2, V2 will get multiplied with -0.8 and 0.6. So if I do that, I will get for element 1, the value of stress is turning out to be 0.8 into U2 is -0.2. +0.6 into V2 is -0.683, which is -0.2498. This is multiplied by 200 into 10 to the power of 3 divided by 500, which is nothing but -99.92. megapascals. So similarly, if we do for element 2, we have 200 into 10 to the power of 3 divided by 500. The value of L is minus 1, so it will become plus 1. M is 0, L is minus 1, 0. The displacements are for element 2, the displacements are U2 V2, U3 V3, so it is -0.2. -0.683, 0 and 0, U2, V2, U3, V3. So now if I do matrix multiplication, this will get multiplied with 1 and this will get multiplied with 0. So therefore it is just -0.2. So therefore sigma 2 will be 200 into 10 to the power of 3 divided by 500 into the matrix multiplication is -0.2. So therefore, sigma 2 is turning out to be 200 into 10 to the power of 3 divided by 500 into -0.2, which is -80 megapascals. This stress is -80 megapascals. So we have calculated the elemental stresses also. Now, coming for support reaction, So let me solve support reaction here itself. Now coming for the last quantity of interest, that is support reactions. We know that the formula for support reaction by elimination method is R is equal to K matrix into Q matrix minus F matrix. We have K matrix here 10 to the power of 4, K matrix into Q matrix. The Q matrix is 0, 0, minus 0.2, minus 0.683, 0 and 0, minus into 10 to the power of 4. So we have K matrix into Q matrix minus F. The reactions are R1, R2, R3, R4. So let me write, you know, to avoid confusion, let us write Rx1, Ry1, so that we understand that the reaction at node number 1 in x direction, reaction at node number 1 in y direction. Hence, we can write it as Rx1, Ry1, Rx2, Ry2, Rx3 and Ry3. So, if we solve this, we will get the support reaction as so we can't do matrix multiplication here, so therefore we should solve by multiplication of matrix only. So if you observe the first row, these two terms will get multiplied with these two terms, so therefore minus 5.12 is get multiplied with minus 0.2 plus 3.84 will get multiplied with minus 0.683. So 4 multiplied by 10 to the power of 4. So the answer is subtracted by 0. So therefore, I will get R1 as minus 26,226. Now coming for Ry1 calculation, so these two terms will get multiplied with these two, so therefore 3.84 is multiplied by minus 0.2 plus minus 2.88 is get multiplied with minus 0.683. So all this should get multiplied with 10 to the power of 4. So the answer is separated by 0. So therefore, we will get the answer as 11,990. Next, coming for row 3, these two terms will get multiplied with these two, remaining are 0. So therefore, 13.12 into minus 0.2 plus minus 3.84 into minus 0.683. All this should be multiplied by 10 to the power of 4, so which is nearly equal to 0. That is minus 12.8, which is nearly equal to 0 because we don't have any support. Coming for Ry3, since we don't have any support, if you calculate also, it will be nearly equal to 0. Next, coming for Rx3, this minus 8 will be get multiplied with minus 0.2. So if I do that, I will get minus 8 into minus 0.2 into 10 to the power of 4, which will be 16,000. Next, coming for R by 3, so R by 3 is 0 newtons. So this is the solution for support reaction. Let me calculate and verify once again for Rx1, minus 5.12 into minus 0.2 plus 3.84 into minus 0.683. The answer should be multiplied with 10 to the power of 4, which is nothing but, sorry, the answer for Rx1 is 15,987. Newtons. So Rx1 is 15,987, Ry1 is 11,990, Rx3 is 16,000 and Ry3 is 0. We don't have reactions at node number 2 because at node number 2 we don't have any support. So this is the complete solution for problem number 1. The displacements are U2 is minus 0.2 millimeter, V2 is minus 0.683 millimeter. Coming for elemental stresses, the stress in element 1 is minus 99.92 megapascal, stress in element 2 is minus 80 megapascal, and this is solution for support reaction. So this completes problem number 1. That's all from this lecture. Thank you all.